Now, that's a fairly good-looking female with that rule of women that if one sees the clavicle, that's adequately slim female. So you can see the opposite side collarbone. So that's a fit, beautiful woman. And the question now is, should we conserve this? Should we operate this at all? Anyone to do the surgery on this? You will operate. Okay. So six people amongst the crowd wish to operate this. That's 2 weeks down the line, and these are the x-rays. Some amount of displacement is there. Now that special view which you see on the left side is the 10 degree cranial angle view, which is the recommended view for the clavicle, which will give you a true picture whether that clavicle is poking out subcutaneously or not in a slim person. So that's 2 weeks down the line. That is 6 weeks down the line, still conserved. Surgeon decided not to operate. And that's 1 year follow-up. That's the range of motion. So this is a case, despite of comminution, despite of a very vulnerable female patient decided to not operate. So non-operative treatment compared with plate fixation or intermediate fixation is the question today. This fracture clavicle today is the biggest debatable issue in trauma, next only to unstable trochanter. So relative indications for operative fixation are becoming widely accepted. Previous myths that clavicle should never be operated is slowly fading away, and we will see in next 5-10 minutes why and which cases we should touch and which cases I showed you not to touch. So the only cases in which we should not touch are the patients who have a great compliance, and you think that you can monitor those patients maybe every week or every 2 weeks and make sure that they are maintaining that amount of reduction and are not getting displaced further. Those are the patients whom you would not want to touch, whom you would want to treat conservatively and push them conservatively, because today we know that especially urban population, especially Google friendly population, if they land up with non-union and malunion, that will lead to significant morbidity to the patient and to you also. So that's why we are shifting away for those 40-50% of the patients towards some kind of fixation, and we'll see what kind of fixation. So that's another story, who is a 42-year-old man, high velocity trauma, again neurovascularly intact. Who would want to treat this conservatively? Okay, now this is one kind of a fracture wherein the displacement is very high on day one. There is no way we can really push it down. Mountain bike, Google friendly patient, again, this is a kind of patient you would want to treat operatively, because this is the patient who is going to otherwise ask you why you did not operate on day one, why did you go for non-union or malunion and morbidity to me. So here is the incision. Here are the very ordinary locking plates which are available to every one of us. And then the choice where to place this plate, anteriorly or superiorly, depends on your choice. But just to look at the anatomy, make sure that if you are using an anterior plate, you know how deep your screws are going to be. Ordinary plate can be contoured well to the clavicle, and in this case placed anteriorly, and that's the post-op and that's the functional result. Okay, so to summarize, in displaced fractures, you are justified in those 30% of the patients to operate on them primarily, and you can use ordinary plates, contour them, Of course, now very beautiful Indianized anatomical site specific low profile clavicle plates are available and we will see them. So what are the fractures then definitely needs surgery in those 99 or 100% patients are this group of distal third. They are only 10 to 15% of total clavicular injuries. But if it is there, these are the patients who you would want to primarily fix. Don't wait and don't be judgmental that in last 20 years of my practice, I never touched them. They don't cause any morbidity. They do. So make sure that you identify them. And of course, there are various classifications, Nears and Robinsons. But let's look at the classification. Type 1, again, they are undispersed injuries. You can treat them conservatively, push them down, strap them. They'll be trouble free. But type 2 injuries are typical injuries wherein there is some amount of displacement. And these are the patients who have high rate of non-union up to 30%. And malunion. Again, type 2 injuries are of two types, wherein this type 2A, there are two ligaments, conoid and trapezoid. I can't see. Anyway, so there are two ligaments, conoid and trapezoid. If they are still intact and it's proven on MRI that these ligaments are intact, you have a different plan of fixation. You can just do the skeletal fixation and not bother about the ligament. So MRI is important in these kind of injuries. But if one of the ligaments or both the ligaments are torn, which can be detected on MRI, then the plan is different because then you have to, in addition to skeletal fixation or plate fixation, also bother about ligament reconstruction. Otherwise, the plate that you have placed will get eroded off. So it is important that you know of these ligaments anatomically and you detect on MRI whether these ligaments are torn or not. So type 2A and type 2B need to be identified on X-ray and on MRI. And type 3, of course, are articular fractures. And in these fractures, again, you have to fix in such a way that these articular fractures are bypassed. So you have to have a plate which will go right across towards acromion for some time, and you have to remove that implant early on. So again, type 2 world is divided into 50-50. Some people still prefer, even in type 2, non-operative. I prefer operative because 100% of fractures have been proven to be healed within 6 to 10 weeks after surgery with excellent results. What are the options? We can start right from K wires, 2 plate fixation, 2 tension band wiring, 2 transfer of corrugate process, 2 hook plate as well. And so let's look at some examples. But for most of the techniques, clavicular fixation, coracoclavicular fixation is also required, especially if ligament is avulsed. So that's an example, far distal fracture. Usually, if this amount of displacement is seen on X-ray, it indicates more towards ligamentous avulsion also or injury also. Here, people prefer to use a hook plate. You can push it down and do ligamentous reconstruction as well. The problem with the hook plate is its position. You need to really know the hook plate, where to place it. You have to place it more anatomically. Otherwise, hook plate by itself, thickness of it can cause subacromial impingement. So make sure of it. And the complication rate, though they are low, are there, which includes new fracture, rotator cuff tear, and as I suggested, subacromial impingement. My preferred technique for acute distal third fracture is this. I give a horizontal incision, reduce, and use a tension band wire technique. I usually always augment my fixation with coracoclavicular ligamentous reconstruction. We have to look for avulsion fracture of CC ligament on X-ray if MRI you don't want to do, but if that avulsion fracture is not seen on X-ray, it is better to do an MRI you will be safeguarding your own skeletal fixation. So indications for late surgery would be pain, weakness and deformity. And the techniques that you would want to use is either some kind of a Weaver Dunn modification, which is excision of distal clavicle, or if a good bony chunk is there, then try to reduce and fix it. That's one example which has come late because there is some resorption there, there is some amount of roundness at the end of the fracture, there is some distal portion still remaining, huge amount of displacement which is seen on 10 degrees cranial view. So that's the medial end, that's the distal end. And here, since the distal end is very tiny, osteopenic, I have tried to fix that with that horizontal screw, but try to secure my fixation with a longer plate towards acromion. What you also see or not see is that coracoclavicular ligamentous reconstruction. Especially in older patients, non-unions, it is essential that you go down and use something of your choice. It can be a semitendinosus graft, it can be a band that is available for ACL reconstruction, but try to reconstruct that ligament. If this kind of a fragment is seen on X-ray, that definitely shows that coracoclavicular ligament is attached to that tiny fragment, and make sure that you take that piece and put it in position. It need not be anatomical at all. You can just do a hook plate there, pull that fragment towards the medial end of the clavicle and tie it across, and it will heal in its position. At least it will try not to rip off your hook plate or skeletal reconstruction, and ultimately it will heal with good functional result. Another distal end of clavicle. Now these kind of plates, also the Indian plates which are available, are site specific, low profile, anatomic, are fantastic. And once you know how to do it, after placing this plate in position, one can, for this distal end clavicle, also augment your fixation if you are unhappy with a K-wire, which you can remove later on just subcutaneously. So what it will look like is like this on image intensifier, and that's after fixation. So don't be skeptical how will that fragment be captured in the tiny plate. You can always augment your skeletal fixation by putting couple of K-wires and make sure that you remove them early, maybe at around 4 to 6 weeks, and the plate will stay there. So that's how these kind of patients look like clinically. They'll be with proud clavicle which is jutting out. There is no way you can keep them down even with strapping, and they will proud out. There are anatomical plates which are available. You can fix it. If the patient is young, it will have a good purchase. So do not worry. Another example is this. Now here there is an adequate amount of bony fragment laterally. You can go ahead and put anatomical plate there. Even a hook plate there. That's how hook plate will bypass the distal fragment. Sometimes you don't need to even put that one single screw in that lateral end of clavicle. You can just push it down, lateral end of clavicle, don't fix with that screw which is there, and push that hook plate underneath the acromion, and it will heal. Longer anatomical plate, similar kind of fixation. If the bony chunk is good, you don't need to augment your fixation, and that will be the result. If the fracture is in the middle area, again you have site specific right and left plates which are available. I prefer to place these kind of plates dorsally than anteriorly. You are safe. You are safer than putting plate antero and going from anterior to posterior with the screws. So this is the configuration which I personally like. A quick word about intramedullary fixation. Some people swear by this. I personally don't encourage it because I have had some brachial plexus injuries in first few cases that I had done. Be very careful, learn this technique. In some patients it is good. TENS is the preferred way. Some people have modified smooth K-wires with some purchasing threads on one end, and they pass it medially. problem is backing off of these intramedullary rods because clavicle has no medullary canal by itself. So you have to actually create that medullary canal, and that's why any kind of intramedullary fixation, may it be tense or may it be modified intramedullary rods, they have very high tendency to back off. But the people, the proponents of intramedullary fixation, pass it from the medial sternal side and go laterally. It's the preferred way for middle one third. Again, the proponents say that there is no scar, but if you do it in a good way, the scar on the clavicle can be vertical also in those patients who don't want to have scar and can fit. It's called as a bra belt scar. The incision is vertical. That also can be practiced. Again, that's surgeon's perspective and preference, but the things are possible. So end of the day, I think we have to choose our patient. Everyone is having their own set of patients, whether demanding, non-demanding. In metros, increasingly patients are more demanding. They would Google and dictate some kind of treatment, especially for a clavicle. Rest of the fractures, they would understand, they will get confused. But clavicle, I have seen patients would come and ask for, I want fixation for my clavicle. Initial days, when I was not doing any kind of fixation, which was 10 years back, I was aghast when those Google friendly patients came and asked me for fixing. But then, as our science grows, as our approach changes, not pushed commercially, but pushed by evidence that if we fix those fractures, the morbidity is really less. We need to fix those distal one-third fractures, which are again 30% of the total armamentarium. But those fractures, initially, when we used to only percutaneously K-wire, had some malunion, had non-unions, and had patients with morbidity. I think these are the fracture locations which would dictate what kind of fixation we want to do. And we have to understand what mode of fixation we will use. So remember, low profile anatomic Indian plates are good, are available, economically not too bad, are a good option today. Thank you.